you've been doing this long enough.
Okay. Nice to see you again.
Good to see you again. So you are now closer to 60 than to 50.
Thank you for reminding me.
Well, are you still the boy wonder? Do you still feel like the boy wonder thing is kind of hanging around your neck?
Well, no, I mean, I think maybe you experience this, but I feel like as you get older, you actually go, you get more infant, you know, I feel like now I'm regressing, you know, I'm entering probably about 13 years old about now, maybe 12 or 13, you know, it's like, I think once you feel a certain way, I mean, you always kind of feel the same way, except the only time you kind of notice something is about when your body starts failing you a bit more, you know? But beyond that, I don't really feel, I always felt like I was like 80 years old when I was a child, so I don't really feel much different.
So you're Benjamin Button-ness. So.
Well, I get that, sir, because I do think you kind of, as you get older, you kind of regress on another level. It's interesting.
So has the work changed a lot for you?
No, I mean, I always treat everything as I go into it just the same in a way. Whether, you know, I don't intellectualize it too much. I just sort of go with what I feel like doing. That's why I don't plan things too far in advance, because you don't know really how you're going to feel, at, you know, in a year or even 6 months. So, so you try to kind of hit each project, you know, with where you're at emotionally, if it connects with you on an emotional level. And, you know, I mean, a film like this, you know, I've been interested for reasons, you know, growing up with the artwork and then the story, and Scott and Larry, you know, did Ed Wood. But also the fact that if after doing a bunch of big budgeted movies, it was nice to kind of do an independent low budget film and kind of re-energize that aspect of why you like making films.
So is that a very different set of muscles than something like Alice, which is...
Well, the Alice is a hard, that one will, you can't even describe how that movie was made, because it wasn't one technique, it was a billion techniques thrown in. I mean, I was lucky to have one person at the set, you know, at a time, you know, and they, even then they were distorted and changed and, you know, it wasn't motion capture, so it was animation and it was the most frightening experience I've ever had, just because you didn't see the movie until... basically it was released, you know, because it was all sort of came together sort of backwards. But so, you know, in this particular case, it was just more kind of like, you know, trying to make Vancouver look like San Francisco and work quickly and move locations a few times a day. And, you know, how much does this cost? How much does that cost? You know, and smaller crew and kind of everybody. So it had an energy that's different than those other kinds of films.
So is that a good thing? Is that energizing to...
It was great. And the fact of the matter is like, you know, after re-energizing that, there's lots of things that I think I can apply. Doing a studio movie, you know, there's an energy and a trying to be resourceful as you can, which is part of the excitement of making a film.
So do you feel the change in the industry overall? I mean, there's always the talk now about dramas not being made and things like that. In the middle, I guess, so things between 40 and, you know, 100 million seem to be dead at the moment. But that's kind of where you lived for a while with the smaller films.
Yeah, but I think you know, those things change. I mean, everybody likes to categorize things. It's like with 3D, everything's going to be 3D, you know? And then people polarize like, oh, it's the death of the film industry or whatever. When in fact, you know, it's not. I mean, these things come around. You know, I mean, I think what I do miss is I miss people in the studio being film people, you know. I that's the biggest thing that, you know, because it's become much more corporate, I miss, I mean, even if you dealt with a studio executive that was a nightmare, you felt that they were film people, you know, and I don't know, I do miss that, you know, and I work with, you know, producer Richard Zanuck, you know, who I knew there was a change in the air when the guy who used to, his father started Fox and he ran Fox, and at the gate they didn't know who he was, you know, I thought, uh-oh, we're all in trouble now, you know.
No, the world is definitely that. He was kind of the end of that chain. And I guess Spielberg's now the end of the chain in some ways.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, it is sad when those kinds of things, because it does sort of indicate an end. And you know, the reason I love working with him so much is that you learn so much. And it was is about film, and it was about the people, and it was about this weird family of filmmaking, you know. So, yeah, I you do kind of miss that. But at the same time, when you're making a film, you still get to create that. All that other stuff goes away, and that's the, sort of the beautiful part about it, is that you still got your weird family there making the film.
It's funny because I think people think of you as an iconoclast, and it sounds like you building that family is a big part of it for you. It sounds like that's part of the joy of it.
Well, yeah, I think
the studio family or the...
Yeah, well, or just the people making the movie. You're all there trying to do something together, and it's slightly dysfunctional. It's like a big dysfunctional family, which, you know, I didn't have, you know, I had a lot of Italian friends, and I knew big dysfunctional families through them. But never really had that myself, and you know, always a bit of a loner. But when you're working on a film, it's just there's something where you're all connected to doing one thing that's quite exciting.
So this was a number of years in process with Andy and Larry, trying to direct
Scotland,
it.
Yeah.
Scott
well,
and
yeah, no, I mean, they, you know, yeah. But you know, I've had that happen too myself, where films took, you know, like I remember Nightmare took about 10 years before to get done, just because it wasn't right, the timing wasn't right, the things weren't, elements weren't quite in place. And so, you know, you hear about that more and more, films taking 10 years to get. I mean, when they say that, it means it's 10 years of sort of, you know, wanking off, not wanking off, but getting, and then in the case of this, when the elements are there, it's like, okay, quick, let's do it, you know?
Yeah.
So you kind of strike while the iron is hot, you know? And so, yeah, but they you know, they've been at this for a very long time.
And it seems like actually that's almost the story this year, is like you have a bunch of movies where this was the small movie in between the big movies, and that turns out to be the great movie that people remember forever and ever. The Inarritu movie, which he was kind of doing in between doing other things. And
yeah, well, I mean, usually, sometimes, I mean, I like to, you know, sometimes when you have too much time to think about something, you can kind of spin yourself into a frenzy. And there's something, you know, to be said for just doing it quickly and just going for it. You know, there may be things wrong with it, maybe things that happen, but there is a real joy about just going in and doing it.
Do you see more things wrong in this than you'd have in some of the longer term movies?
No, I have trouble watching anything I do. So, you know, I try not to, you know, I'm not one of those guys that, you know, that some filmmakers have done, like, oh, you know, I wish I could have had, you know, this, you know, and they add new special effects and things and update the movie kind of a thing. I think, you know, it's a bit of a time capsule, and I think that you accept them, you know, for their, you know, their strengths and their flaws. It's all part of what it is.
Well, the two Batman movies are really kind of the end of the pre-CG era. I mean, I guess there was some computer work in there, but not a lot. None.
No.
But I mean, that was all in camera.
Yeah, you know, you kind of, I mean, there's great things you can do with CG, but, you know, it's like with stunts. I mean, you know, the old, like, James, you know, when you see a real stunt, you see real cars, you see real people, you know, falling off a building. I mean, there's an energy to that, that no matter how well it's done CG, you're missing some kind of human connection to it that I think, you know, even though I use CG a lot, I've used it a lot, I always talk with people about the crew and stuff. If we can do something live, then let's do it, you know, if we can do it that way. That's why, like, at something like on Alice, I didn't do like one technique, like motion capture mixed to animation and everything. It was just a complete hodgepodge of techniques, and so you know, you use things as a tool. Some things use that for, some things you don't, you know. But that for this, it was particularly enjoyable to just focus with the actors and our crew.
One, the production design, and, you know.
Yeah, no, I mean.
That house is a character, certainly.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it was fun, you know. I think, again, the biggest struggle was to make Vancouver look like San Francisco, you know. So, you know, but that's the fun of it, you know. That's the fun of the challenge.
You guys did paint the skies a little bit, or some of the landscapes, didn't you?
No.
It looks like it, and those, particularly in some of the wide shots early on, it looks to me like the back, almost like the sky is a little keen.
No, we didn't. No, I mean, we didn't really. I mean, because one of the things, you know, I talked to Bruno, the DP, about was, is like, we didn't want to treat it too much. You know, I mean, we talked about, for some reason in my mind, I had like Mario Bava films and his kind of color schemes in my mind. I don't know. I think it's because the artwork sort of had that kind of weird, lurid, kind of colorful but slightly creepy color schemes in the painting. So that's why I think I thought of Bava movies in that sense, because it just seemed to connect somehow.
Mm. Hitchcock?
A little bit of that, yeah. I mean, just in terms of the relationship, I don't know if it's because of San Francisco or the vertigo thing or whatever, but there was something and about the sort of obsessive and the kind of controlling and the kind of dysfunctional kind of relationships that felt slightly Hitchcock to me.
So what, in terms of the script, you'd been reading it for years, I guess the variations of it, according to the guys at least. Was there a thing that finally hooked you, that this was, besides the fact that you had the connection to Keane? And
yeah, well, I think it was a combination. Like I said, we were parallel universes, and I didn't know they were writing a script. But after obviously working with them and Ed Wood, when I heard about it, I knew, well, of course, it's right up their street. They excel in this sort of thing. So I think it was just a combination. You know, first I was just going to be a producer, and then it took so long, as things do. After doing a couple of big budgeted films, I think the combination of that and also loving the material, and then, you know, when Christoph and Amy got interested, it just felt like, okay, now we can let's just make this thing, you know. And Scott and Larry were, you know, gracious enough to just go, yeah, let's go. Let's just get this thing made.
So how does Amy click in for you? What was the reason she fit so well into this?
Well, because, you know, as good as the script was, the hardest thing to put on the page is Margaret. Because how do you... She's so quiet. She's so shy. She's so internal. You can't really write that, you know, in a way. And the minute I talked to Amy, I just knew that she really got it, and to me, I've never dealt with a performer or performance where she expresses so much so internally. I mean, her performance amazes me, you know, because it's not showy, it's not big, it's not this, but it's just heartbreak, you know, just you know, you just see the internal, and it's so subtle. I mean, she's like the most quiet, under the radar feminist I've ever met, you know, because she can't, you know, scream it from the rafters. She's doing it in her own private, the only way her character and her as a person could do it, which is quite amazing, you know, because it's easy to see a person like this fall into the victim category, but, you know, she's always said she went along with it, she's complicit, doesn't really blame, you know, he was a nightmare and a bully and all that sort of stuff, but, you know, even going to court, I don't think it was out of vindictiveness, she just wanted to a burden to be lifted, and even after she won, she wasn't screaming from the mountaintops about it, you know. And so, and again, in Amy's performance, just the tiniest little thing of just, you feel the weight lifting from her a little bit, or you feel gaining her power, but it's on such a subtle level that I was just amazed by it.
So do you map that out with her, or do you just let her go do her work? And
well, no, I mean, we talk about it, but the thing with, it's interesting, because actors, you know, Amy works different from Christoph. Everybody, you know, every actor I've worked with, they have their ways they like to approach things. And, you know, for me, I'm not the type of person like, you know, that's why I don't storyboard as much. I show them a storyboard, do this, you know. You try to let each person kind of go through their process. You know, it can be difficult sometimes because if two actors are working together and one person likes to be method or the other person likes to do it line by line, you know. And so, but the good thing between Christoph and Amy is that they're two actors that, even though they work differently, they respected each other's sort of, you know, way they like to work. And that's a really important thing. So for me, it's not something we really mapped out. I just felt, again, from the very, very beginning, she was Margaret. Do you know what I mean? So you don't sell, you know, so I was just sort of guiding along in terms of trying to, you know, because it's such an unbelievable, that was the biggest trick, because it's so outlandish, you know. No, it's, you know, nobody, it's like the courtroom scene. People think it's over the top. It's, we had to tone it down, you know. So.
And Christoph does get, I think this is his most, the opportunity also to do the most complicated performance, the most layered performance he's ever done, at least in American film, because he goes everywhere.
Yeah, he goes everywhere. I mean, that's the great thing about him, is even though he plays whatever people like to call villains, I don't think Christoph considers him a villain, and he's not, because he's a complicated, like everybody, you know, and to do all those shades, the charm, the expansiveness, the bigness, but then the darkness and the bullying and the tragedy of him. And also, he was kind of, you know, to be fair, without him, Margaret's work might have never seen the light of day, you know, and also the whole printing. I mean, whether you like it, I mean, what started then continues today. I mean, so he was sort of ahead of his time, or right there, at least at the time of this kind of process.
Somebody said the sequel should be about Peter Max.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, it was a definite thing that's continued. You know, you walk out of the museum gift shop and there's posters galore. You know, I mean, that's where the money is.
Do you ever feel like you're on that cycle? I mean, your movies have a lot of merchandising and
Well, I love toys, so I love, you know, I'm a big toy fan, so I. Some are better than others, but yeah, I mean, I think it's, well, look, it's become a part of it, and you can't really avoid it. I mean, the only good thing about this movie is that there's no McDonald's tie-ins, or you're not hearing the word franchise or anything, which is nice. It's just pleasant.
It'll be interesting to see what kind of McDonald's tie-in they can come up with. It's Big Eyes Cups, yeah. Big Eyes Happy Meals. Yeah. I see it. Enormous hit. So I guess you're not surprised at all by Michael Keaton this year either.
No, it's great. I haven't seen the movie, but I hear he's amazing. And no, look at, I mean, that's why I worked with him so many times, because he's just, you know, to go from Beetlejuice to Batman, two different things. He's an explosive actor, you know, and that's very, very exciting. I can't wait to see it.
So you have a history of an intense relationships with actors, or there is that sense of you like your, you know, the people you really like.
And yeah.
Is that, were you that way from the beginning, or did it take a while to get used to them being part of
your vision? Well, yeah, because as starting out as an animator, I was very shy and very, like Margaret, I didn't really speak. And so, you know, doing live action, I was quite lucky to work with people like, you know, Paul Rubens, Pee-wee's Big Adventure, a lot of people that come from improv, and then Michael Keaton, you know, Catherine O'Hara, lots of people that were really, that opened my eyes to another way of working and creating and seeing, you know. That's why, you know, I don't storyboard as much, but you just let people, you want to see, you, a lot of the work is done at the beginning, in the sense of like, okay, it's like with Michael, you know, Beetlejuice, or, you know, or Margaret, once you know who they are, then you've got the freedom to just play around, you know, and try things and do things. And, you know, he's definitely, I mean, you know, he is that character, Michael Beetlejuice. That's him.
So, I mean, is your role to, with the actors, to build the place in which they're going to get to play?
Yeah, I mean, I have to feel confident and comfortable. I mean, that's what I said, that there's a foundation of what it is, you know.
And which is both the set and the script, or is it?
But everything. I mean, that's why, yeah, everything. And that's why, you know, I don't think you finally realize, that's why, well, you never usually have the opportunity to do large rehearsal periods of time, because usually your actors are all over the place and, yeah, you know, no, 3 weeks in a room rehearsing. Because I find that you don't really know what you're getting until, you know, finally, you know, the costume, you get the actors, you talk about the performance, you get the feel of it, you feel like they're that character. Then it's the costume, then it's the light. You really don't know what you have until you're really there on the set. Mm-hmm. That's the whole thing. But you have to feel confident that the framework and the foundation is laid, so that there is then that room to. And some scripts, you know, you love every word. Some scripts, some actors can say a line, give that another actor that same line, doesn't come across the same mm-hmm. way. So you're always kind of having to kind of deal with those kinds of things, because everyone's different.
And you know while you're shooting whether things, I mean, obviously you're saying cut and take and yeah. you know what you're going to print, but are you comfortable that it's all coming together as you go always? Or
well, I mean, you think you are. I mean, that's kind of why I like these themes like Ed Wood. I mean, you know, he's making Plan 9, he thinks he's making Star Wars, you know. The Keens are doing this, they think they're doing the Mona Lisa, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, you do get caught up in your sort of bubble of enthusiasm and creative, you know, energy. So, mm-hmm. yeah, I mean, you feel like you're getting it. Whether you're really getting it or not, it remains, you know, that comes later.
Do you feel like you've gotten it? I mean, do you feel, looking backwards a little bit, do you feel
Well, yeah,
like-
because I feel like, the interesting thing, I like material, and this was a real case in point, I go like, good luck, whoever's going to have to sell this movie, because what is it? You know, it doesn't fit into any kind of category, because it's, you know, but that's what I like about life and this kind of material. It's a mixture of, you know, dysfunctional relationship, which is both tragic and funny and absurd and dark and light. And, you know, I mean, all those kind of things mixed together, you know, it's like I was trying to make a drama, but it's too absurd and funny. There's just too much humor in it. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, it's like why I could probably never make a horror movie, because I find them funny, you know. And I found these people, again, quite tragic and sad and funny and emotional all at the same time.
But I mean, do you look back and go, okay, Batman's fits in this place in my list of films versus because it's a huge hit and, you know, people were shocked how much money it made and everything else.
Yeah.
It just kind of changed the game at that period versus something like Mars Attacks, where even though it did well, it was not considered as big a hit or whatever, yeah. A little bit of a disappointment. Does that change your perception of the work at all? Or
no, because I've been lucky enough to see it all. You know, like first two movies I did, Pee Wee's Big Adventure, Beetlejuice, were on the 10 worst films of the year lists.
Many.
Yes.
Wow.
And then later, somehow that changed. Maybe it was because I made other movies that they liked least, that those became classics. I don't know, you know. But I've experienced, you know, like Ed Wood was one of the most critically well-received movies I've ever done, and it was the biggest bomb I've ever done. You know, I mean, so, and then movies that get critically panned can make, you know, Batman was not the most well critiqued film of the year, I would have to say. It skirted the worst film of the year award, but it wasn't far off in terms critically. But so, you know, you can't really say, you know, that's why the whole question of what's good and what's bad, or what's art or what's not, is it art, is it kitsch, is Ed Wood the worst filmmaker, you know. But you remember his films. So it's an interesting question. It really has no answer, but I find it's something that I've dealt with quite a lot.
Does it answer for you? I mean, do you take pleasure in the films you've made at this point?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I can't really watch them. I have trouble watching them. But, no, I'm proud. You know, I mean, you know, just it's an accomplishment to get anything made, you know. So no matter what, I, you know, and even films that people go, oh, that wasn't very good, I don't regret any, you know, I don't regret any film, you know, because I think it's just part of your life, and it's part of, you know, a fairly big chunk of your life that you put a lot of your heart and soul into. So, you know, you kind of, you know, I it's not an emotional place I want to go to or need to go to.
Right. Is there, is your work been enhanced, or your life been, well, I'm sure your life has been, but your work been enhanced by being away from Hollywood so much, or living in England? And
well, yeah, I mean, you know, the only thing I don't like about it is that the phone, I hate being on the phone, and when you have to deal with LA, it's like you have to be on the, you know, because in LA, they don't, I don't think they realize there's any other time zones than, you know, LA, and then there's whatever. So that's the only thing I don't like about it, because if I get on the phone past 6 o'clock, I can't sleep for the rest of the night, you know. So that's the only thing I don't like about it. But no, I mean, I think the reason I moved to England and all, I just felt weirdly at home there. I don't know why. Weird. I don't have these past life experiences, but I did that time. And I just, the people, I got friends, and I just found the eccentricity of it more to my, you know, I think, as I said before, I like being a foreigner. I felt that way in Burbank, even though I was a citizen. But I think I'm kind of a loner and like to kind of move around a bit.
We've been a family man for quite a while now.
Yeah, yeah.
So has that changed that at all, or is that?
Well, yeah, no. I mean, it's amazing. You know, it's hard because you know you do have to be away a lot, but and you are drawn more to trying to, especially at the age where they're, you know, I'm sure when they become teenagers, I'll probably do all my movies as far away as possible.
Right, and they'll buy the tickets for you.
Right now, it's nice to be around them.
So what was the hardest thing to get right about? I mean, I guess Margaret was really the...
That was, because it was, you can't be, it's not on the page, you know, you can't really see it. And that's, to portray the complexity and the subtlety at the same time is not something that A, is necessarily on the page, or necessarily a lot of people could do. And that's what, again, it's like, that's why I was amazed by Amy. She could just sit there with a blank face, and I'd almost start crying, you know, just watching her and just feeling that inner, because it's not you're she doesn't have these giant scenes where she can have a fit or scream from the, it's all in there. And I think, wow, you know, that I've worked with a lot of great actors, but that's a performance I've never really experienced before, that quite that level. I mean, Michael and Batman did that because he had to, again, that sort of internal thing. And, you know, people thought of that, oh, you know, Jack steals the show. But for me, Michael's performance is the grounding, and it's the harder, in a weird way, performance. In the same way with Margaret, it's really hard to do that kind of stuff.
In a weird way, it's how Winona grounds Beetlejuice also.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, that's why I like actors like, you know, Johnny or Winona or Michael or all these people, you know, they're like silent movie actors. They don't have to do anything yet to convey something. And that's like Zen acting. There's something about it that just is really amazing.
So you're already in pre-production on your next film, yeah?
Yeah.
So is that... reads like, at least from a distance, like a kind of like a little bigger than this, but not really a big.
Yeah, I mean,
crazy
it's
movie.
Big, but not. I'm trying to keep it, you know, because there's a weirdness to the book and a slight, there's a bigness to it, but at the same time, at the root of it, it's like a family story, which I like, you know, with all the weird shit going on. It's like kind of really, you know, and that's something about the book. There's a weird kind of secret intimacy about it that I like. You know,
what's an interesting thing, because people are surprised by this movie with being your movie, but Big Fish was on some, you know, there was the fantasy element, but that territory is there. This does feel more, I guess, straight.
Yeah,
than
done. But it felt necessary because the story itself is so outlandish. It felt like it didn't need. It was more interesting for me to keep it simple and grounded because the story itself is so ridiculous and slightly unbelievable. You know, that it just needed to have the some kind of grounding, I felt.
Do you think that would have been your choice as a director 20 years ago, or would you have tried to?
Well, I don't think I think that way. I don't, you know, I think I just approach things the way I approach them. And I mean, I approach everything like it's real, you know. So that whole thing, blurring of fantasy and reality, or what's normal, I mean, that word normal always freaked me out, because, like, you know, people that were presented to me as normal, while I was presented to be weird, I had a difference of opinion, I would say, about what normal is.
I probably still do.
Yes, oh yeah. It gets worse.
Thank you so much for your time.
Nice to talk to you. Yeah, good to see you.
Good to see you.